Nkrumah. Samia, good morning and happy new year to you.
Good morning to you. Happy new year as well.
It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here. Yeah. So let's quickly jump into this. So what? There's been several resignations at your party. Well, we saw before the last election Dr. Pakwe Sindum exit. And that was what, when you were chairperson of the party. We see Dr. Abu Sakara exit as well at this time. And some have suggested that you indeed are the problem.
Then I must be a very strong woman.
I guess.
But don't you find the coincidence a bit strange?
Tell us
so
about
in
it.
Every election year, 2012, yeah. 2016, yeah. A leading member disappears from the party. Do you think this is a coincidence? We think not. We think it's political machination meant to weaken or tarnish the image of our party.
By who?
In an election year.
By who?
By people, our opponents, people who don't want to see us rise. I believe it is because we pose a serious threat, particularly this year, that there's been yet one other attempt to make us look bad. You know, why don't we talk about the divisions within the NDC, where the wife of the founder of a party is reported to be wanting to stand as presidential candidate on another ticket? Why don't we talk about the division within the NPP, you know, where the chairman of the party was suspended?
Well, they're all in the news.
Exactly. So with us, we close ranks. Nobody has been suspended, but we have certain leading members who choose in an election year, not before, not a year before, not 2 years ago, but right in the at the beginning of an election year. The same thing happened, repeating itself. Why is that? We wish them well, because nobody tells them to go, but they obviously have a reason and an agenda for leaving in a year, so that people say, oh, the CPP is not united.
But did you, with Dr. Abu Sakara, for instance, did you see this coming?
We did, I'm afraid.
You did?
We did.
What was the relationship like before here? What was the relationship with you and Dr.
There was no disagreement. If you're talking about me personally, I mean, I wasn't even the chairman of the party at the time he left. There was no disagreement, no obvious conflict with the party. So it is peculiar in that, but as I said, it is not surprising if you look at the whole political map. I think there's a great fear and terror of having CPP and Nkrumah and the cockerel, our logo, on the ballot paper.
The NPP and the NDC are seriously afraid of you?
Of course. Having that combination that I think rekindles what Ghana was, where Ghana should be today, I think there is that great fear. Everybody knows that the two parties, main parties at least in Ghana, have not really performed as far as improving the quality of lives of the people. Since 92, every 4 years we go and vote. And what happens? Let's ask the average Ghanaian if their lives have improved. I don't think so. The answer is clear. So sooner or later, a catalyst will come and things will overturn.
Are you the catalyst?
Kwame Nkrumah's vision, adapted to today's circumstances, is the catalyst. We are not coming in our personal capacities. I think people must understand this very well. But what we are coming with is a vision that has worked for Ghana, a vision that can work once again. You know, if your father or your mother, your ancestors, if they leave you copious notes, advice, good advice on how to manage the affairs of your household, they leave these for you, but what do? You discard them, you abandon them on the shelves, and you go and seek advice from people who don't know your circumstances, your environment, your context. What happens? What happens? Can we do that, honestly do that? This is what we've done. We've abandoned our economic plans. We've abandoned an independent development path that was supposed to follow our political independence, so that we gain economic independence. We've left all this and we've turned to the IMF, the World Bank, to ask for advice as to how to run our economy. Do you think we'll succeed? No, never. So It's not only the drivers that need to change, but the direction in which the bus is going.
And you think that as the daughter of the first president of this country, you would, you know, be given the nod to lead this country and probably bring to bear the ideas of
It is inevitable that we go back to the drawing board and see what Kwame Nkrumah left us. It is inevitable. And I think if we don't do that, we are never going to progress as a nation and as a people.
Is the CPP living in the past?
Yes.
With this constant reference to Kwame Nkrumah?
Kwame Nkrumah is for the future. Does Ghana have a functionable gold refinery? Do we have, are we sufficient in the production of sugar? Do you know we would have been in 1970 had we pursued the plan? So what are we talking about? We are talking about things that we have not managed to achieve till today. People said Kwame Nkrumah's ideas were ahead of their time. Well, 50 years later, I think it's time. It's time to look at what those plans were. Countries like South Korea have gone on to implement 5 or 6 development plans from the 60s till the late 90s. Look at where they are and look at where we are. We were producing cars. I mean, we were way ahead. Now we are struggling. Our local entrepreneurs who go into manufacturing are struggling. The government or the state is not giving them any incentive. So as a result, our manufacturing sector contributes less than 5% of our GDP. Now, no country can become strong. You cannot create jobs, offer jobs. You cannot be a confident people without a manufacturing sector. You cannot. It has not happened. So it is time that we reassess ourselves and have really a revolution, economic revolution, agricultural revolution. Look at what is happening in agriculture. We invest very little compared to many things. As a result, we cannot feed ourselves, a country that is very fertile. Now, if you look at the 7-year development plan, agriculture was a very important sector, agriculture and industry. We would have been self-sufficient. We would have been able to produce our food. And then, in the 60s, we didn't have the threat that is coming to us now, that is pushing poisonous genetically modified foods on us so that our food chain is controlled by big multinationals. Today, we are under that threat, not only Ghana, many African countries.
Have you lost that fight? You've been pushing
we
against
GMOs. We haven't lost it at all.
There was just some time is it a fruitless fight for you?
No, the Plant Breeders Bill that Parliament was ready to pass about a year or more ago is on the shelf. 51 organizations, not only the CPP, 51 organizations petitioned Parliament against the passage of that bill.
What's so wrong about that bill being passed in Ghana? What is the threat to Ghana?
That threat goes beyond even the bill because there are certain regional agreements hovering around, you know, for us to accept those GMO seeds into our system. Now, once you do that, they have consequences, health-wise and economic consequences, particularly on our farmers, small-scale farmers, who are the majority, as we all know.
We're talking to Samia Yaba Nkrumah. She's a presidential hopeful on the ticket of the CPP. It's exactly 300 days to election 2016. And we are speaking about why she wants to be president of Ghana one day. Samia, you were making a point quickly about the GMOs and why the CPP and you have opposed
Number one,
the GMOs.
Yeah. Yes, GMOs, scientists have not agreed that they are safe.
Genetically modified organisms.
Yes, seeds, crops. Now, scientists have not agreed that there's no consensus amongst them that they are safe for human consumption, which means that even if you eat them, nothing happens. In years to come, they could have serious consequences, you, your children, and so forth. Now, number two, these seeds are mostly seeds that we'd have to import. Our farmers will have to import them. And they are terminator seeds in the sense that once you plant them one season, you'll have to buy them the next season.
You can't store the seeds and then grow again for the next season.
And they go, normally they go with serious pesticides. Now I believe the future for Ghana is the opposite. It's organic farming, organic agriculture, less chemicals. You see, we are very big on industrializing, on building up our local industries, but with a human face. I think we have to respect the environment. And Ghana can become a serious producer of organic vegetables and fruits. And that is what is in demand in the whole world. We'll get a lot of revenue from that, and we'll be healthier and safer. So we would rather push for that. We'll promote that. If we were in government, we would have banned GMOs, and we would have weaned ourselves off very dangerous chemicals in agriculture. I think that's the way forward for us.
Okay, you'll definitely have talked about how that this current government has mismanaged our economy. What will you in particular, leading the CPP, what would you do differently? And let's look at all the aspects of the economy. You just spoke beautifully about the agri sector. What would you do differently? Let's say health, education.
The first thing about running the economy is what path or approach are you taking? Now, we are saying, I know this is big English, but the new liberal approach, the IMF's approach, because that's what we've done. Immediately after 66, we had advisors from abroad, and we threw away our economic plans. And the first thing they tell you is you have to privatize, which is to sell off national assets. That's why we sold off many enterprises. Ghana Telecom went, ECG's under threat, it is going. So this is serious. You know, the average Ghanaian must understand why we are poor. We are poor, we have inflicted this poverty upon ourselves by wrong economic choices. So the moment you accept the IMF dictates, then it means you are going to sell off your national assets one by one. And you are going to focus not on creating employment, but on controlling inflation. So it's for a developing country, it is very serious when you take that approach. You are going to retrench labor, so you cannot employ. There's a ceiling as to the number of people you employ. And you are going to de-invest in industries, in manufacturing. And you are going to neglect all the social, big social sectors like education, health. This is the way, you know, the new liberal approach goes. So the average Ghanaian suffers high costs in electricity, water. Everything is put on the burden of the average person.
Exactly.
Not on the big, big multinationals. Now, so the first thing is we have to get our act together and stop listening to the prescriptions of the IMF. Have an independent path to development. This requires courage, but other countries have done
How courageous are you?
Thank you.
We are very courageous
you.
Because, yes, I'm very courageous because I am armed with a vision and with a lot of people. There are a lot of competent people in Ghana today who can save this country. We put our heads together and we have our own plans. We are going to revive. We have committed to modernizing the 7-year development plan. We have no doubt about it. I haven't seen a better document for Ghana till date. So we are committed to reviving it.
This was a plan drawn up by President Nkrumah?
Not by development economists, Ghanaians, Africans, and even international ones. So a lot of work went into it. A lot of serious work, but we
how
just
relevant is a
it.
Plan that was drawn up 50, 60 years ago?
It is very relevant because, as I started saying, what it would have achieved has not yet been achieved. And we give a few examples, our gold refineries, our industries, you know, even our energy. You know, today we would have focused on renewable sources of energy, solar, wind. So the point of the plan is we have achieved nothing, not a fraction of what it would have achieved decades ago. So it means it is more than relevant.
Given that times have changed and all, you think that it's still...
Times have changed, but we have not changed. Our economy has not changed. We are still an import-dependent economy. So our problems have not changed. This is what we have to understand very well. But I was saying, we are poor. Number one, not just because we've mismanaged the economy, but also something else that the plan touches upon, which we have not done. We have not increased our share of ownership of our national resources. So the CPP is going to tackle that. We cannot have a 10% share of our production of
How are you going to do it? How
we
are you
have
do
to
that?
Renegotiate investment codes. We have to renegotiate agreements. That takes courage, but it has to be done. You cannot call yourself a free nation if you do not, your people don't own your natural resources, because that will give you a lot of more revenue to meet the basic needs of your people, starting from education. We cannot remain a nation where the average Ghanaian student has to beg to complete the higher education. This is ridiculous.
And you're talking about higher education, preschool level, there are still problems. And
there are problems all the way.
Yeah, that's supposed to be the
yes,
basis.
Because you have a shrinking government that is incapable of taking care of its people. This is what happened. But this is the new liberal approach. The government keeps on becoming weaker and weaker, the state, I mean, to the extent that it offers nothing. So people will have no sense of love for their country. You know, compare that with richer countries where education is facilitated. Students are even given allowances to complete their higher education. Mm-hmm. These are countries that are thinking ahead, because you need a skilled, strong, confident, protected workforce. What we are doing, we are heading towards a state where most of our people will not be educated or will be badly educated, have no confidence in ourselves. We're going to be beggars in our own nations, because we'll be importing more and more, you know, and our land will be taken over. Everything we'll have to buy from outside. This is not a way to build a nation. And this is not how Ghana came into being. If we had that spirit, that mind, when we came into being as an independent country, we would never have achieved independence, you know. And people must believe that it's possible to overturn a system. There are challenges, but it is possible. This system must be overturned. So there must be a revolution at the ballot box. You know, we have to believe that it's possible not to follow the IMF, but to follow Nkrumah's development
policies. And you said something about the lack of foresight and vision for the leaders. Since President Nkrumah, which of the presidents in Ghana have had the vision that you are looking for?
No one has had it. People have tried. We are not, you see, this is not a personal, we cannot limit it to presidents.
But it has to be, because our system is a presidential system. So if
yes.
you get to the Flagstaff House, you will be
yes.
responsible for the good and the bad
of
and
course.
The ugly.
Absolutely.
So a lot rides on the person who is in the
sure.
Flagstaff House.
But these presidents have been a product of parties, of supposedly a way of thinking, ideologies, and we are saying that is what is wrong.
So there's something wrong with the NDC ideology. There's something wrong with the NPP ideology.
There's no even ideology.
They don't have any ideologies.
No, they claim to be, I don't know,
they say they are social democrats.
Yeah, whatever that means. But they have not practiced even anything social, because as I said, we've been selling off our national assets. We've been decreasing our share in gold in every single national asset.
How about the property-owning Democrats that the NPP said? Isn't that good for
Ghana? But they are the same. The NDC and NPP have followed the same path of development. So we need to overturn that system. You see, leaders, they've tried to do things here and there, but they have not relied really on the potential of this country. They have relied on outsiders to dictate to them how to run this country. This system has failed. And the average Ghanaian has to wake up and realize that unless we have a total overturn, a revolution in the way we manage our affairs, we are going to remain poor and we are going to suffer, to continue to suffer. Something has to give. And yeah. it is not impossible. If we could send the British away at independence, we can send the NDC and NPP packing. We need to overturn the system. Then we regain some control over this economy of our resources. Where we are heading is loss of total control.
Your party
for
is
the
weak.
It's,
CPP is a shadow of itself. Your presence on the internet, I went onto your website, conventionpeoplesparty.org. The latest press release there was from 2012. you're not in touch with the young people who are supposed to bring you into power.
The youth of the party are the strongest element. Just a month ago, our youth organizers from all over the country came to converge in Accra Poly to donate blood. Now, which other party organizers have done that? They actually donated blood, all of them. So the blood of CPP youth is running in the hospitals.
But you're definitely not just targeting the youth of your party. No. I think what Kafui means is in this day and age of social media.
They are leaders. They are leading by action. They are leading to show that we are capable of giving.
Exactly, what are they doing?
We are capable of giving if given a chance. You see, we have a history that has kept us down. A history of imprisonment, banishment. The party was banned from using the name for decades. Properties confiscated. But now we are rising. We are rising and we are getting our act together. You talk about NPP and NDC. They claim they have 1 million plus membership each. So where do the other 7-8 million votes come from? They come from floating voters. Now, are you saying we are not capable of convincing or persuading those millions?
You haven't done it in the previous elections.
We haven't done it because we haven't had the right combination. But let's see what we can do this year. You rightly started, is a special year for us. Right. It's a spiritual year. 50 years since Kwame Nkrumah was kicked out of this country. We, his followers, are not going to sit down. This year is special for us. So we are going to go all out to make sure that that voice of reason, of vision, is heard in Ghana.
Are you bitter against those who kicked President Nkrumah out?
Never, never. We are not bitter against anybody. They were deceived into collaborating with some, foreign hidden hands. They were deceived into thinking that Kwame Nkrumah was not doing something good for this country. And the sad part of it is that it has affected us till now. Because as long as you vilify what Kwame Nkrumah was trying to do, then you won't be able to free yourself. So it's time to liberate ourselves from those misconceptions.
Have we made Kwame Nkrumah into a saint? And that is stifling
us. He's a political prophet. No doubt about it. And I think we need to study as we are doing. We are studying his policies, his speeches, his writings, because I think the solution to our problem rests in these ideas. Definitely.
Jace, today your comments are flooding in on 0288500600. I'm sure Beso also has some Facebook comments that you read and Instagram as well. So keep them coming in. We are chatting with Samia Yaba Christina Nkrumah, CPP presidential hopeful. She was the first to file in her nomination on the last day of last year when Dr. Donko was resigning. She was filing to become a CPP presidential candidate. Back after the world in 60 seconds. Stay with us. Don't go anywhere.
African Paralympic champion Oscar Pistorius has appealed to the country's constitutional court in a last-ditch attempt to overturn his murder conviction for killing his girlfriend in the year 2013. A vote is expected in the U.S. House of Representatives this week, possibly today, Tuesday, over a debate on a bill called the North Korea Sanctions Enforcement Act. Venezuela's Supreme Court has ruled out all actions of the opposition-held National Assembly as void until 3 banned members are removed from office. Teaching has resumed at the Kenyan University, where 148 students died in a gang attack last April, but only a few students have turned up for its reopening. Talks aimed at kickstarting negotiations for a final peace settlement in Afghanistan have begun in Pakistan.
You're watching GH Today. We're chatting with Samia Nkrumah, CPP presidential hopeful. Your questions on 0288500600. And on Twitter, follow us at GH1TV. You can follow Samia too. She's at Samia Nkrumah, S-A-M-I-A, and Nkrumah, N-K. If I spell Nkrumah for you, you're not a Ghanaian. Okay? So Samia at Samia Nkrumah, and you can follow her also and send your contributions to her.
Well, on the note of the departure of the darkness where the light comes in, let us read some of your contributions, and this one says that, and it's from Cyril Flint in East Legon. He says, please ask your guests why the smaller parties can't come together, because that's the only way they can come to power. I'm coming to that. I have a question for you on that as well.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Delwyn, and I'm loving Madam Samia on your show. Okay, so a lot of love being shown you. It says what, Madam Samia, I like your courage. Yes, I like your courage. Okay, he just says I like your courage, and it's coming from Awudu in Tamale. Loads of other messages. Okay, so good morning, Kafui and Beiswa. Please ask your guests what she brings to the table. Okay, let's get some responses from here, and then we'll read some more.
What do you bring to the table? I mean,
A vision, mm-hmm. and clean, incorruptible management of our economy and affairs. It is very important. You see, what Ghana needs more than anything else, aside from the vision, is also strict honesty and integrity.
You don't see that in this administration, the previous ones?
But look at all the judgment, debt, corruption scandals. This is untenable. But that normally comes with lack of vision. You see, when you have a vision and a plan, it's difficult to go beyond the boundaries. You know, people don't know that the Volta River scheme, the whole project, was completed under budget and ahead of schedule. You know, there's a reason for that. Kwame Nkrumah became the chairman of that whole project. So, you know, when you follow strict principles...
So he had direct, oversight responsibility.
Yes, and you follow principles. You know, ideology now is a bad word. They've made us believe it's a bad word, but it's simply a set of principles and beliefs. We with our religious beliefs, we have certain rules. Don't do this, do this. It's the same with your ideology. You know, put the interests of the people first before yours. You know, you are not in politics to enrich yourself. You know, you have to serve, you have to sacrifice. And I think we need that. We need leaders who will sacrifice, who are not going to get rich when they go into politics. You know, this is a mission. You know, it's not ambition, it's a mission. And we've been saying our mission is to complete what that great leader started. It's a mission.
Let me give you some feedback on Facebook. Of course, you can follow Samia at Samia Nkrumah on Facebook. Henry Ablo, tweeting at Henry Ablo, says, I'm feeling Samia Nkrumah this morning. Hashtag GH today. CPP is too weak to win, though. He likes you, but he likes the driver of the vehicle, but he thinks the vehicle is a chinchima. It's not going anywhere.
That is the revolution that has to happen first in our minds. You know, that's what we said about colonial rule. It's impossible. We are nowhere near the British in power. But that doesn't mean we couldn't succeed in sending them away. You see, so it's a mental shift. There's nothing, the vision is huge. The message is right. So there's nothing that can stop us from
asked the question about why the smaller parties are not coming. And I even want to forget about the other ones, but the Nkrumahist parties. This conversation has been happening and recently I think I heard you say that the CPP was not going to join forces.
I personally, but many of us in our party, we've invested heavily in these unity talks, merger talks. We believe we are one. And let me tell you, when I went up to Upper East to campaign for the PNC candidate in the Tallensi by-election in July, it was proof to me that the PNC and CPP activists on the ground are one. You couldn't tell the difference. We were polling agents for the PNC. I mean, and I was campaigning day and night for our candidates. So we are united on the ground. So as for that becoming one, it's inevitable. I want everyone to understand that. It will happen. Because once the rank and file think in a certain way, they are going to push leadership. Now, why it hasn't happened at the top or formally is another question. And I can tell you in all honesty, it is interference from the bigger parties. Because it is not in their interest to see us united.
But you made less than 3% in the election. You're a fly in the soup, and they want to take the fly out.
Individual percentages put together still does anything. Not make, you know.
No, but that it's not like 2 + 2 = 4, because it's a psychological also upheaval that you get with that unity. But what I want to us to understand, it's not a question. It's not the coming together that will get us more votes. It is choosing the right combination of representatives. You know, I believe that if I represent our party this year, the message will be louder and clearer, and people will listen. After all, I'm very experienced in getting votes. You know, I've led several campaigns from the Jomoro campaign where our share of votes more than trebled when I came on the scene. The same thing with our the seat we have in northern Ghana, the Kumbungu seat. I led the campaign there, and we won the seat. So I'm very experienced in getting votes. You know, we know how to attract more voters because we speak the truth. It is not difficult to do it. If we haven't done it in the past as a party, it's perhaps the choice of our representatives was not up to scratch. So let us this year try with a vision, with a woman carrying or armed with a vision. Let us see what will happen.
So you're thinking that the time probably is right now. With you in the race, let's not forget that we don't even have you as the flag bearer of the party. Yes. How many people have picked the form so far?
We have four. Three men, yes, and myself. Yes.
Who are they? Could you just run them by us?
Yes, there's lawyer Bright Akwiti, who's been with the party for a while. Then there's a businessman called Joe, who joined the party a few years ago. Mm-hmm. And then there's our former general secretary, Ivor Greenstreet.
Okay.
So three men against a woman. Yes, I'm used to competing with men.
There was a chap called Onzi. Yes. There was a chap called Onzi Nkrumah.
Yes, who's a fraudster, I believe.
So because there were suggestions that he was supposed to be a relative.
Yeah, he claimed to be. And unfortunately, the state media quickly started referring to him as Kwame Nkrumah's son. But it's never happened anywhere that suddenly out of the blue, someone gets up and says, I am the son of a famous person. And it's accepted without question. We believe he has to submit to a DNA because he's not only claiming he's Kwame Nkrumah's son, he is also getting into the political domain. So this is very serious. And I believe there's political mystery.
Did the chiefs accept him at Nkrofu?
I don't know if the chiefs accepted him or not.
Because I got the feeling that he had been accepted by...
The four known children of Kwame Nkrumah do not accept him. Mm-hmm. And we believe the way he entered into the scene in this high-profile manner also...
He's that brother that, I mean, perhaps you all never knew.
He is not. And would the brother even try and challenge? He is his sister, has been MP for the party, chairperson of the party. You've come from nowhere. You know, your whole nationality. How did you get your nationality? We were, 4 or 5 years ago, you were introduced to me as an Egyptian man. You were not Kwame Nkrumah's son. What happened? What's going on? So we seriously believe it's politically motivated to muddy the waters. But I told you there's great fear of having CPP Nkrumah and the cockerel on the ballot paper. There's great terror. I think that image is terrifying our opponents. So they will do anything to try and...
And what would you say to an NDC person who is just laughing in his beard? He says, man, listen to the Samia lady. I mean, how can we be scared of you guys? So. You haven't done much in the past. Past performance is probably an indicator of future performance.
I don't think NDC supporters are laughing. I think they are listening to us very hard. I think a lot of them will even vote CPP. I don't think they're happy with the way things are going on in Ghana.
You think the CPP is a threat?
NDC supporters still pay high electricity bills. I mean, when you a few months ago, you were paying 60 per month, 60 CDs. Now you are paying 100 CDs. I don't think
CPP will bring their bills down?
Absolutely, by a revolution in the way we manage our economy. We will. We are committed to doing that. This is the result of bad management, which favors a few and the rest of the nation.
One question on Onzi before we move on. I was meaning to ask if he was disallowed to pick up forms because you refer to him as...
We are a democratic force. He actually failed to meet the requirements.
Okay.
If I'm not mistaken, to the best of my knowledge, the check he presented, there were insufficient funds, let's say, when they checked.
The check bounced. Okay.
Against the check. Bounced check. So it is, he couldn't meet the requirements on that score.
It was a heavy amount, though, 155,000 CDs?
Yes, and we decided... I mean, we are a revolutionary party. Yes, we, under normal circumstances, this would be too high, unacceptable. But many of us decided to sacrifice. It is our choice. After all, we are not taking this money from the people of Ghana. We have levied ourselves. We have agreed. We sat together and agreed to levy ourselves and sacrifice for the party. This, whatever is left after Congress, will go into helping the party get logistics.
Some good money there. 620,000 from four of you.
Yes, and we, it is our decision to sacrifice for the growth of our party. And moreover, a lot of us, it is the support. My fee was helped. I was helped by many of my supporters.
Great. I'm happy to see that
spirit, you know, of giving and of sharing. And this is what true leadership inspires. You know, genuine leadership always inspires support from many people. This is, Kwame Nkrumah was not a rich man, but he made miracles for this country. You know, the idea that a politician has to be rich It's neither here nor there. It's actually quite ridiculous, you know. Let's go back to the idea of politicians who are, you know, who are like in the Bible. You know, their greatest asset is their wisdom, is their goodness, not the size of their purse. Okay. So a lot of comrades, a lot of people have helped me to pay that fee.
What does that mean? I'm very grateful.
Even some of our youth contributed.
What does that mean for you? Does that suggest that they think that you could be a better candidate to lead the party?
It suggests that, yes, that people are behind you, that people see a vision, clearly a vision that's waited to be implemented.
Messages from Facebook. Kafui Do says, can you endure the insults of Ghanaians and their maltreatment? Because we just don't change our attitude. Even the men are not surviving the insults and the vilification. Can you insult that? Can you survive that?
And I have survived it, yes, for a few years. Yes, and you have to be ready to. I mean, this is nothing. You take it in your stride. And when you are focused, on what you want to do, what you want to implement for your people, this is nothing. Insults, what can they do to you?
Ernest Gabla on Facebook wants to know that in case you don't win the slot and you don't win the entry to Flagstaff House, will you help whoever wins to achieve the goals of the country?
You mean, yes. Of course, but I am committed to seeing a CPP government, or at least a CPP-led government come to reality, to achieve a vision. Not for, as I keep on saying, it's not an ambition, it's a mission. You see, unless the mind of Kwame Nkrumah, the spirit of our ancestors, unless it is there to guide us, we are not going to succeed. From what we've seen over the past few decades, we are not going to succeed without that guiding hand, that guiding mind. So we are committed to install a government that will think like Kwame Nkrumah.
The current government, the head of which is the president has a press conference today at 11 o'clock at the Flagstaff House. We don't know what he's going to tell us. In your view, how has he fared so far these past 3 years? It's 300 days to elections.
Poorly.
Does he deserve a second shot in the Flagstaff House?
No, definitely not. And we've said it time and time again. But what is wrong is not just the way this president has handled affairs, but the way we've been handling affairs for the past few decades. You know, and we are saying, if we continue in this path of selling our national assets, losing control of our resources, then we are going nowhere. We are going to become paupers and beggars in our land. We are already beggars in our land, but it's going to get worse and worse. We have to stem, we have to stop this tide.
How do you grade him?
And reverse
How do you grade him if you were to grade him today?
I grade all, not just our president, but some, past ones, all of them very poorly.
It's a C, a D, an E?
It's
below what? Below E?
Yes, because it's leading.
Look, that is failed.
Yes.
For you, it is an accumulation of mismanagement.
Yes, and the system has failed. We have to understand.
And lack of vision, like you put it.
It is not delivering. We have to get it into our heads. It is not delivering. And I know the reason we are being challenged is because, you know, when you want to overturn a system, it's not an easy thing. It's not an easy thing. So you are bound to be, people will try and stop you, will try and push you down. So seriously, we need a revolution.
Is the president powerless? Let's take, for example, the current Guantanamo Bay detainees in Ghana. You think he could have acted differently?
Of course. I mean, look at in the 60s when Ghana under Kwame Nkrumah resisted. When the French government at the time wanted to explode its nuclear bomb
in the Pacific,
in the Sahara, yeah. Mm-hmm. Look Pacific, at the sorry. Uproar we caused. This is what we talk about when we say we had an international standing, a voice, a strong voice in international affairs. Ghana protested. Look at the when the former Rhodesia. The unilateral declaration of independence. Ghana protested. So our voice was heard when something was going to harm us. But not when you simply don't understand what was the deal. Who has benefited from whatever came to Ghana from accepting these two men?
You're not assured by the assurances given by the foreign minister and the ministers of
Do we understand what happened? Do we understand how this deal was broken?
You think we've not been properly engaged?
People, and that is one of our problems today. You know, there's no participatory democracy, what we call in NGO language, mm-hmm. You know, no participatory democracy, no participatory budgeting. So people don't know what's happening and are deliberately not informed, you see? So for many of us, it is very sad that we've become a country that is, you know, toyed with, that we are given instructions that our people don't even understand. What makes us proud about this action? What is in it for the average
Ghanaian? We are part of the international community and we are lending
a
helping hand to people who need refuge.
People who need refuge?
Yes. That's the argument that the government tells us.
People who need refuge?
Yes.
Do we know who are these people and why do they need refuge?
Well,
and why should our country become embroiled in this whole Guantanamo scandal? I mean,
we accepted Liberians this whole in 1990. Affair, why can't we
Liberians,
accept just two,
we accepted
two detainees
African,
who have been cleared by the U.S. government?
We accepted African refugees. A day will come when our countries will be one. It is our duty to integrate. You know, it's for prosperity. If our economies were more integrated in West Africa, in the continent, we would not have poverty.
Should we have accepted the Gitmo guys if they were Africans?
Do we understand what Guantanamo Bay, the significance of that whole move? Why should our country get involved with that? Let us protest when there are poisonous seeds coming into our country. We don't say anything. You see, we need explanations. I think the government owes us a huge and big explanation to the people of Ghana.
I think the Foreign Affairs Minister has been very categorical. She says we've done our background checks. And we spoke with Felix. Once again, let me go back to Felix. And he says some of the issues are security-based and we can't put it out there.
We want to know what Ghana and Ghanaians have benefited.
So you definitely agree to calls to have them returned?
We should never have got ourselves involved in this. We should never have. This
Great.
Has nothing to do with Ghana. It has nothing to do with our prosperity. It has nothing to do with our safety and security. It has nothing to do with us.
What would your father make of this decision, knowing him?
I think he would not be happy. Just as I said, when he spoke to the world, he spoke to defend the people of Ghana. Whenever he spoke on the international scene, it was to defend our people. That is all. Our solidarity is with the people of Ghana, first and foremost, and the people of Africa, because we don't distinguish between them. And that is why I gave the example of the atomic, you know.
Let me ask something other than Gitmo. At least now we know your position. Do you think that President Mahama has handled the power situation properly?
He has not handled it well, and neither have past governments. You see, if we had followed the 7-year development plan, we would have been sufficient.
Can you run us through the plan again?
The plan is immense, but its main focus is our industrial policy and agriculture. The two things actually we need to focus on today as a nation that wants to move from one level to another. So, and you cannot build up your industries without a reliable and safe power supply. So it's not just for domestic consumption, but you are thinking of a reliable supply that will help you build up your industries.
Now, industry suffering.
Yes. How many people know this? But by 66, the arrangements to build the buoy dam were complete. So we were about to start constructing the buoy dam. Now we waited, 40 years. I mean, that is strange. It's mind-boggling. 40 years to construct the dam in the same place, but, big but, with reduced capacity. So we can't even do things that we could have done much better in the past. We can't even, when we want to do them, we are doing them badly. Take the Commander Sugar Factory that we say we've resuscitated. It's done very badly because Ghanaians don't really own it. The benefits will not come to us.
It's owned by an Indian company.
Yes,
correct.
Another serious thing that's going to happen to us. You know, most of the profits of what we produce is repatriated.
What percentage of the oil do we say nothing,
10% of the production, share of production. Yeah. Now you see big hotels, super posh shopping malls, but what does the Ghanaian own?
Samia, if you came into Flagstaff House, you'd go around renegotiating a lot of these things.
We have to. This is what we did after independence. You see, we need the second coming of independence. The people of Ghana must give the CPP a second chance.
You're going to anger a lot of capitalists.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we will negotiate with them and they will eventually benefit more because it's better to have a government that is paying attention to the needs of its people. In the long run, it's better. There's more stability and more peace. The way forward is to be fair and just to your people. The capitalists will end up enjoying more, better deals, but we will dictate to them. We will tell them, you want to come and do business with us? We need to build up our industries. Eventually, all will benefit. You see, it's a myth. A stronger Africa is a stronger Europe, is a stronger America, is a stronger Asia. The world for humanity to move in peace and prosperity is for us to be fair with each other. Let us not shy away from these things. We need the second coming of the CPP government. We need to be courageous. We renegotiated a lot of things after independence. After political independence, you need economic independence. If you don't achieve economic independence, you are going to go back to being a colony. And that's what Kwame Nkrumah spoke about when he coined the word new colonialism.
How hungry are you for power?
We are determined. I'm hungry, but with love.
With love. Please explain.
Yes,
how can you be hungry with love?
That is why we are saying we need a revolution at the ballot box. We don't need to kill each other. We don't need to hit each other. We don't need to burn, properties. But we need an upheaval, a social upheaval. You know, we need to revolutionize the way we are doing things. And it begins with that revolution at the ballot box. 7-8 million people must change their minds completely and have the courage to bring back the mind, the spirit, and the thinking of Kwame Nkrumah. I think the only thing that really worked well for this country.
And I think that that last question that you asked about renegotiating has been asked by a viewer. And so I'm very happy that, I hope you've been answered.
Yes, they must support us to renegotiate. Yes, yes. They must support us to change the investment code. The people of Ghana must support us to give them back greater share of ownership. It has to be done. We must not shy away from it. We must not be afraid. Yes. This is the path to our prosperity. You know, and if you have an honest government, that revenue that comes will not be taken by a few. It will be shared by many. And that is where you have that word that people are terrified of, socialism. It is simply sharing.
Are you a socialist?
Of course, by conviction, and I'm not shying away from it.
What does it mean to be a socialist for you? No,
it simply means making sure that basic needs are met, education, access to basic access to health by everyone, basic access to education. Education is the biggest social equalizer. Everybody must have the opportunity to reach their
potential. Name three countries, socialist countries that you look up to.
Look.
Worldwide.
You take the Scandinavian countries. I believe they are practicing socialist-oriented policies because everybody there's no poverty. Look at Norway, when every Norwegian has a share of the oil of that country. What do you call that? You see, we are just afraid of isms and names. So you don't want us to use those isms, we won't use them. But we are basically saying that basic needs must be met and people must have fair opportunities. Every Ghanaian must have fair opportunities to reach their full potential. But to do that, you need a certain way of managing your affairs.
And to do you need to get into Flagstaff House.
Yes.
Voters register issues.
It's in the hands of the people
of
Ghana.
Yes, indeed. But
it's in the hands
what's your take on the voters
Ghana?
Register? There's been a lot of ink spilled on this, a lot of words spoken on radio.
It is not rocket science. We have said it must be changed, and we gave the example of the Jomoro constituency.
You said it was bloated, and that's how come you
but
lost.
It's figures, yes, but we are going by figures. We are not, this is not sentimental or talk. Pure figures. From between 2004 and 2008, the valid votes cast changed by between 500 and 600 votes. Valid votes cast.
It increased. More people were being born in Jomoro.
Listen to that.
Qualifying to become voters.
But listen to the figures. 500 to 600 votes. Now, between 2008 to 2012, the valid votes cast increased by almost 11,000 votes. Now, tell me if this is logical or realistic. From 600 to 11,000. I think there's something very wrong.
A lot of relocations. I mean anything could have happened.
Did you complain? Make a formal complaint to the EC?
We decided. It happened. We didn't want to be embroiled in the Supreme Court.
Then you have yourself to blame because we didn't know.
Oh, but you know now. But we decided. You know, this is just one incident. Our eyes really is on changing the whole way Ghana is managed. So we can take one constituency, one incident. That doesn't break our resolve. We didn't even stop in our movement to persuade the people of Ghana that we need a new system. That didn't deter us at all. But we know the figures speak for themselves. So something terribly went wrong. And exactly. If it happened in one place, it could have happened elsewhere. So we have indeed called for
I think it happened in Kwabena. It happened in a few areas.
Mm.
But listen, I mean, knowing your position, I would love to know what you make of the EC's statement that came out on the register as well.
Yes.
What's your take on that?
Right now, I don't think I can speak for my party. But when I was chairman, we demanded a new register very strongly, you know. And of course, I am not happy with the fact that we can't have one. But we are not going to sit down. We are going to make sure we will audit, we will scrutinize name by name if need be. There are many volunteers who are ready to help us with that. Because democracy must reflect in a better quality of life. You know, and the will of the people, that is non-negotiable. It has to be reflected. So that this is something we are not going to take lightly at all. Okay. Yes, not happy with the position of the EC, okay. But it will not deter us from even taking up this auditing also ourselves.
I'm still kind of trying to think through some of the issues that will be, you know, the president will be kind of putting out there this morning. And we've talked about the Gizmo.
Yes, the energy.
Exactly. And I'm thinking the taxes that was greeted us beginning of the year.
But that is what we are saying. This is the new liberal approach. This is the dictates of the IMF. You know, it is capitalism, as one famous economist said, it's capitalism for the rich. Capitalism for the poor, socialism for the rich. So the burden of all our economic chaos, the burden will be on the average Ghanaian. Higher taxes, higher cost of basic utilities, it will happen. Don't be surprised. Because it is as a result of economic policies.
And CPP, hopefully, when you come in, you change things.
Unless you change that, we are going to continue with these hardships.
Listen, Samia, immediate future. Now, four of you have, and we're wrapping up, four of you have filed your nominations. What happens next? When will you meet?
Congress, end of the month, God willing. Mm-hmm. End of the month, we'll have our CPP 2016 flag bearer, and we are off.
And if you don't win, and if you don't win?
Nothing stops me from working to achieve that vision. Great. So nothing would change, just as nothing has changed over the last few years. Yes. I'm winning.
Teeny question.
That's fine.
Someone was trying to place your accent. He says your accent doesn't sound Ghanaian. Why do you sound the way you sound?
So do you want somebody who tells you lies but speaks with that, whatever the Ghanaian accent is? We have different accents. When you come from the Volta region, you speak differently from when you come,
from the north.
Yes. Mm-hmm. No, I know. Mm. So it's a legitimate question. Mm. But that's what I'm saying. Let us think of what people are saying. The sincerity or level of sincerity and vision, not how they speak. Because I could mimic your accent but tell you lies. You know, we were kicked out of this country. I was less than 6 years old. We were uprooted from our culture, our tradition, our people. You know, we had nightmares. We were lost. But it is my choice to come back and contribute to our country's development. So let us take that into consideration. When you wonder about my accent, it wasn't my choice. So, you know, I was thrown out of my home.
I guess Kafu is asking because, you know, people travel abroad, they go to America, the UK.
Accent must within
a week, the accents change.
It's a combination of Arabic, Italian,
and mine
English,
must be
a
combination of things. Mm-hmm.
Different languages that you
we
speak.
We were refugees in Egypt. Mm-hmm. I studied in England, in Italy. So it must be a combination. But one thing I can tell you, I have an international outlook, so I'll be very good for renegotiating our.
You miss journalism. You were a journalist before.
Indeed.
Do you miss journalism?
Indeed. Do I miss journalism? Yes and no, but I'm doing what I was born to do, I think.
Which is?
To be president
of God. Complete our father's unfinished
business.
Agenda.
Yes. Grazie. Shukran.
Shukran.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Okay. All right.
That's which one was that?
Shukran is Arabic. Grazie is
thank
Italian.
Thank you. Yes.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Well,
it's been amazing having you here. I wish we could go on and on and on. We know you have so much to talk about. It would be interesting to see a female president of this country.
Yes, I think women make up 51%, or if not more, of the population. So I think, it's only democratic. Yes.
Let's see how that plays out.
We thank you for agreeing for us to drag you out of bed.
And we are not just women, we are mothers.
Okay.
We are mothers. And we bring that mother love.
And not just mothers as well, but women of substance.
Absolutely.
Great.
Thank you very much.
All the best.
I'm in good company.